9,999, 10,000. Oh, hey, I didn't see you there. I was just finishing up an exercise routine that I saw online. The internet has some great tips for your fitness journey, but you can't believe everything you see there. Even this trustworthy SciShow host did not just do 10,000 reps. As tempting as the fitness shortcuts you see online are, results like these mainly come from consistently putting in the work. But there are a few research-based ways to level up your workouts. You should just know what's supported by science and what's bogus. So let's burn off those myths and bulk up on the facts to help you feel more confident about your workout. Exercise programs often advertise that they'll help you burn off that belly or get rid of your arm fat. While exercise generally is one way you can lose weight, the literature is pretty divided on whether doing arm day every day will actually target the fat in your arms. Exercise affects the whole body, even when you're just using one group of muscles. You store energy all over, and when you're burning fat, those fat molecules can be pulled from any body part. To test this, a team of US researchers compared 45 men and 59 women doing resistance training in one arm only. They used MRIs and skin fold measurements to compare the fat between the participants' trained and untrained arms. The idea is that if the exercises could really target the fat in their arms, the trained arm would lose significantly more fat than the untrained arm. And that's what happened. But only for the men, and only when they looked at the skin fold measurements. When they looked at the MRIs, both men and women alike seemed to have similar changes in both arms. So even in this one study, results were split between the ability to target fat and all of that being kind of make-believe. The skin fold measurements might have disagreed with the MRIs because they're only telling part of the story. When your muscles get bigger, they can push on the surrounding fat and compress the space between the fat cells. So the same amount of fat would take up less physical space even though nothing was lost. This can make it look on a skin fold measurement like there's less fat when really everything is just smooshed together a little tighter. MRIs can be a bit more revealing. They show your fat mass throughout the whole cross-section of your arm, regardless of the attached muscle mass. So the MRI results are seen as more accurate, and the researchers didn't recommend taking any major conclusions away from the skin fold measurement alone. But science is all about repeating trials and testing hypotheses from a bunch of angles. So a different study looked at 16 men and found that they could target fat loss around their abs. In this study, one group did ab exercises plus a 27-minute run, and another group did only a 45-minute run with no ab exercises. Those two exercise routines take about the same amount of energy. All of the participants had their body fat measured by a highly accurate full-body x-ray called a DEXA scan. The researchers found that while both groups lost a similar amount of fat overall, the group that did ab exercises lost significantly more abdominal fat than the treadmill-only group. So the researchers concluded that targeted fat loss is possible in men, which puts targeted fat loss in the middle of the road, with some research to support it and some that doesn't. Just note, these sample sizes are pretty low, and comparing different populations of men and women doing different workouts makes it hard to draw any definitive conclusions. And trying to draw out anything more specific than fat may prove to be even more tricky. If you've ever signed up for a hot yoga class with the promise of sweating out the toxins in your body, I have bad news for you. Sweat is 99% water. The other 1% includes natural byproducts that your body produces as a side effect of being alive, like carbon dioxide, urea, and salts. Even with a full body drenched in sweat, there's simply not enough of those things in your sweat to count as toxic. And when toxins do build up in your body, it's your liver and kidneys' job to filter them out. Some people with heavy metal poisoning may have more heavy metals in their sweat, but not enough to change the fact that you still have heavy metal poisoning. Now, there is an exception from a 1980 study. Across 30 participants, cadmium was released in significantly higher concentrations in sweat than in urine. Still, that is a pretty small sample size, and the study is a little dated, so there's some limited evidence that you can sweat out those toxins, but I wouldn't rely on that as your main method of poison control. And unless you're exposed to heavy metals on the regular, hot yoga isn't going to help you release much besides water and salt and stress. But there might be other reasons to put the hot in hot yoga. Maybe we've convinced you that just the act of sweating isn't enough to count as a full body cleanse, but you might choose to crank up your workout temperature for a different reason entirely. You might have heard that hotter environments will improve your performance, and that may be right. There is some evidence that heat can improve your cardiovascular health. One study published in the International Journal of Yoga, we have a journal for everything, found that participants who did hot yoga showed more aerobic fitness improvement than participants who did room temperature yoga. The heat probably adds a bit of extra stress to your cardiovascular system, which can be a good way to improve your cardio performance. This also seems to be supported by research into the cardiovascular benefits of sauna bathing. Just the act of basking in a hot room could help lower your blood pressure, reduce inflammation, and improve lung function. So if you're one of those people who got the gym membership to turn over a new leaf, but you only ever go for the sauna, it turns out that's not the worst thing you could be doing. There is an upper bound, though. Too hot of an environment can cause unnecessary strain on your body. Saunas are not recommended for people with certain cardiovascular conditions, and extreme temperatures come at the risk of heat stroke or heat exhaustion. But within reasonable limits, if your goal is to improve your cardiovascular health, exercising in the heat does seem to have its benefits. If you've ever looked at your daily step count and breathed a sigh of relief once that counter got to 10,000, you're definitely not alone. Some people will tell you that's a kind of magic number that's essential for good health. And while you might not need exactly 10,000 steps, there may be something to the idea. Getting a lot of steps in is good for you because it moves your blood around and keeps your bones and muscles in shape. To really put those steps to the test, a group of researchers looked at 78,500 people in the UK. The team used data from participants who wore a pedometer all day for 7 days. After about a 7-year follow-up, the researchers analyzed the rates of cancer, cardiovascular disease, and death in the context of how many steps people took. They found that the more steps per day people took, the lower the chance of all those health problems. The best part is that there seemed to be no minimum threshold to benefit from getting more steps in. Some activity is better than no activity. So 10,000 steps weren't specifically required in this study to see results, which means that if that number feels like a stretch goal for you, you can start at a lower one and still reap the rewards. Another study of nearly 17,000 women found that even those who took just 4,400 steps per day saw significantly lower mortality rates than those who averaged 2,700 steps a day. In fact, depending on how old you are, 10,000 may be overkill. A meta-analysis of 15 different step count studies found that the actual number of steps associated with a decreased risk of dying anytime soon was about 7,000 steps for people aged 60 and older, and about 9,000 steps for people under 60. So you don't need to get in exactly 10,000 steps, but the fundamental idea of getting more steps seems valid. Though, this next claim might be a step too far. There are plenty of people on the internet who talk about lactic acid causing soreness after a workout. First off, let's get one thing clear. Lactic acid does not exist in the human body. This idea isn't just a little wrong, it's very wrong. Your body tissues have a pH of around 7.4, which is basic. So yes, scientifically speaking, yeah, basic. The pH of a substance is determined by its concentration of hydrogen ions. The more hydrogen ions there are, the more acidic. When we say that a molecule is acidic, it means that that molecule has one or more hydrogen ions to give away. And basic molecules tend to pick up those hydrogens that are oh so kindly donated by the acids. When you put an acidic molecule in a basic environment, that acid will give its hydrogen to the basic environment and turn into its non-acidic form. So lactic acid, which has a hydrogen to give, donates its hydrogen to your body's basic environment and then floats around in its basic form, lactate. If you think that those two molecules sound like potato, potato, I'm sure there will be an army of biochemists in the comments who would disagree. And while lactic acid definitely isn't the thing that makes your muscles sore after a hard run, Lactate is also not the culprit. Lactate leaves your muscles almost as soon as it's made, so it doesn't really have time to cause any pain. Here's what really makes you feel sore. Under normal activity levels, the energy-storing molecules called adenosine triphosphate, or ATP, get broken down inside your mitochondria. That breakdown of ATP releases one hydrogen ion, which is acidic. But the mitochondria also recycle those hydrogen ions, so the acid doesn't build up in your cells. The mitochondria depends on you breathing in enough oxygen to do all of that. But when you're exercising really hard, your cells are using up oxygen faster than you can breathe it in. So, in order to keep fueling your workout, ATP has to get used up in your muscles outside of the mitochondria. So your body is breaking down ATP and spitting out all those hydrogen ions into your muscles. And the more those ions build up, the more acidic your muscles get. That process is called metabolic acidosis, which leads to immediate soreness. So it is an acid causing you to feel the burn, but it isn't lactic acid. In fact, the basic nature of lactate helps to clear away the excess hydrogen ions from your muscles. And while we're talking about sore muscles, we've got a lean into stretching. If you're trying to prevent getting sore muscles after a workout, some people may recommend stretching. While it is a staple of many warm-ups and cool-downs, there isn't much scientific evidence that it ultimately helps with soreness. A couple reviews have looked at a combined total of 17 different studies on stretching and post-exercise soreness, but they couldn't find any evidence that stretching after a workout does much to prevent pain. And no, the type of stretching does not matter. A 2014 study randomly assigned 57 participants to do either range of motion stretching, like laying on your back with one leg up to the sky to stretch your hamstring, static stretching, like sitting toe touches, or no stretching after exercise. There was no significant difference in the amount of post-exercise soreness they experienced. So stretching probably won't be the answer to your workout soreness woes. In fact, it's possible that post-exercise stretching will make the soreness worse. Long-term soreness is due to the micro tears that happen in your muscles when you exercise, and stretching can worsen those tears. But maybe something more soothing, like a bath, might help. Taking an icy plunge after a hard workout has been a tool of elite athletes for a while now, and it sounds reasonable that cold water could help speed up muscle recovery. After all, we use ice packs to reduce the inflammation around minor sprains and injuries all the time. Some research has shown that elite rugby players can improve their jumps with a 10-minute cold plunge after a hard day of training. And high-performance athletes struggling with pain throughout an especially intense week of practice may also benefit from the pain-relieving properties of the cold. But over long periods of time, ice baths may be counterproductive. A study from 2015 found that men who used cold water plunges after their workouts for 12 weeks saw significantly smaller muscle gains than those who did not. So reducing blood flow to your muscles can help with the pain relief, but that very same process can slow down muscle growth. For now, it seems like how useful an ice bath is depends on your level of performance, the type of activity you do, and your goals. Our bodies, workouts, and capabilities are all so different that it's hard to make a vague claim that holds true for everyone or even most people. But hopefully this video helped you shed a few fitness myths while reassuring you about other things you may have heard, all without breaking a sweat. Which reminds me, it's time to get back to my workout. 1, 2, 3.